Доброго дня, чи вже вечора? Будемо розпочинати.
Good evening. I apologize for this technical delay. My name is Yuliya Tychkivska. I'm one of the co-founders of Bendukidze Free Market Center. Together with my colleagues, I have spent time with you today, Alexander Denluk, Vladimir Fedorin, and Mikhail Saakashvili. We'll start our panel discussion. We have great guests. It will be on education reform. I represent Kyiv School of Economy. I'm responsible for business management education at Kyiv School of Economy, which is a partner in this event. Who believes that education is important? Who believes that education is not important? We'll discuss this at the panel discussion. As you know, this conference, our center remember the ideas of Kahem and the kids. I'd like to make a quick introduction before we start here the discussion with our guests on views of Kaha on education. Many of you may know that Kaha has five lives, two of which were very closely related to education. First life was Kaha as a researcher who dealt with biotechnologies. Second, Kaha, a businessman who did good business in Russia. Third is a reformer, whom we all know well, and the team of Mikhail Saakashvili. Fourth life is creating the university, Free Agrarian University, the most popular university in Georgia. Maybe some of you have been there, and it's really impressive phenomenon of the global level. And fifth life, Kaha is Ukrainian, really took care and helps our country. Education is more important than weapons. The participants will agree this is what Kaha shared in his life. It's the view of classical liberalism. I have heard about classical liberalism, free markets. The attitude of Kaha to education was like to business, as to business in particular. Very often it sounds pragmatic and people don't like it. But this is what Kaha actually believed. You can read it in the last chapter of the book by Vladimir Fedorin, by Empire. It has a lot of interesting stories. One of the principles that Kaha saw for efficient system of higher education is affordable luxury or affordable excellence. There is a great comparison of education to the coffee market. Have you been to Starbucks? Great. Starbucks is the example of implemented approach of affordable luxury. And there is cheap coffee in the States. I have a lot of kiosks selling cheap coffee. There's luxury coffee in Italian coffee shops, and there is something in the middle. You can meet a millionaire or a student in Starbucks coffee shop, and this approach, Kaha wanted to use this approach. It was his view on education. It has to be affordable for many, but it has to be of a high quality. And today, I guess our panel discussion represents different segments of education. They're involved in education. I'd like to introduce Ina Sovsun, Deputy Minister of Education. You may know her. She is involved in reforming issues. We're very glad she's with us. Yegor Stadniy, head of think tank CEDOS, the Center for the Research CEDOS. Ilya Filippov, representative of EdEra project. No, what is medicine online courses? I believe that 80% of education can be transformed into online education format. Sergei Marchenko, the expert of Bendukidze Free Market Center and Coordination Center, which was involved in drafting reforms on education for many years. Tymofiy Mylovanov, one of the founders of VoxUkraine project, the professor of Pittsburgh University, you can see on your screen, which is next to you. Thank you very much for coming. And we start with the situation from the Ukrainian context. Who believes that we have high quality, great education? Right. If we look at the statistics, we don't want to talk hot air. There is the index developed by World Economic Forum. One of our researchers, Tom Kopetsky from the School of Economy, wrote a great article on the role and quality of Ukrainian education. Talking about Ukraine, the strain of global competitiveness of the countries, Ukraine occupies position 31 of 144 countries. Not bad. Based on the coverage indicator, in Ukraine, the coverage with higher education, we're on position 13 from 144 countries. Very good. But as you know, the average level of salaries in Ukraine is 4,000 hryvnias, the average. What makes our country the country with the lowest average salary in Europe? This is not very positive. At the same time, you know, so what's the GDP of Ukraine per capita? Optimistically, $3,000 per capita. We can debate about the exchange rate. This is World Bank data. Based on the classification of the World Bank, where the country with the level of income below average. Based on the same index, position 13 on the coverage of higher education, but there is also quality assessments of higher education. In this rating, we're number 72 in terms of quality. There is another very interesting pillar, the criterion, the main requirements which envisage the quality of institutions. It's 87 from 144. This shows that we have some internal problems. We have problems with quality of higher education. I would like to start with Ina and her vision of the status of education and what are the plans, what should be changed today. Good evening, dear friends and colleagues. I am pleased to see so many people in the evening to discuss education reform. I would like to believe that this interest to education reform shows that we need to do a lot of things, and without active involvement of the public, hardly will we be able to implement these reforms. Many of you, all of you, know that in the previous year the new law on higher education was adopted. It was the first big systemic comprehensive law that was adopted that reformed the specific area of life of the society. Why it was the first from the systemic laws that were adopted? Because this reform, this bill, was drafted several years before that. I was a member of several working groups, even before the revolution, before everything started, when it seemed that any reform is impossible because there is Dmytro Tabashkin and his deputies. It is just impossible to have the comprehensive reform of this system, which was built in the way to enrich specific individuals and not to bring the quality into education. It seems impossible, but still some work was carried out, and there was work among experts and in universities on the reform of education, how to do it. So as of 2014, we had three bills in the parliament which suggested the vision of how the education system should develop. And this preparedness, these bills that were available, allowed to do it very expediently, very quickly, to adopt the legislation to change the system of higher education management. On September 6, 2014, the new law enters into force. Is it a lot? Is it not enough? Has this law changed the situation radically? What are the key critical aspects that you believe are the success? First, the education reform cannot take place in one moment. I told Eka Zgulasa that I envy her, that she can take people from the streets and train them for 3 months and make them the policemen. We cannot do the same with the professor. We cannot train the school teacher in the same way. We cannot make this change as quick as in other environments. Education change takes some time, but we may make some changes. We can produce some results in the short term. What were the main things that were built into the law on higher education? The priority idea is to provide a great autonomy to universities. You all have heard about this idea. It was widely discussed. We have centralized management system in higher education, and it's hard to provide quality through total control in the system from the ministry. This is inefficient. It doesn't work. It's not right. It's impossible. The idea of the law was to expand the autonomy of universities. When we came to the ministry in September 2014, the ministry was captured by the students in the process of revolution. We started to work with universities. One of the key points, which I realized very quickly, that autonomy is right. Autonomy is the way forward, but we need to realize that only 5 or 10 or 15 universities really are ready for the autonomy. Overall, we had more than 300 universities in the country at that time. Most of these universities were not ready for the autonomy. When I visit smaller universities, when I tell about new ideas, a new law on higher education, it's very simple. The ministry, 1 year ago, adopted the order which abolishes all the previous standards of higher education, in which universities were prescribed which courses should be delivered on which specialty. This is not full autonomy. They are not told the list of specific courses they are supposed to deliver. When I come to the campus, when I talk to the professors, I see panic in the eyes of the professors. They say, who will guarantee the quality of programs? I say, you will guarantee it. It's your responsibility, it's your objective to guarantee the quality of education. As the ministry, we're supposed to say what you're supposed to achieve, how to achieve it, how to organize the training process. What do you do for that? It's the objective for the specific university. Unfortunately, the practice showed that most universities were unready for that. They were not ready, and this did not fit the vision of most of the university community. Do we need so many universities in Ukraine? It's the next question. Next question. We have too many universities. It's obvious. This is what everyone says. If we look at the statistics, in 1991, in Ukraine, we had 190 universities. As of 2014, we had 320 state-owned universities, plus a couple of hundred private universities, plus colleges and technical schools, and this number was 800 or so. This is not normal, we have to work on that, but it's impossible to do it at one moment of time. There are some academically weak universities there are which are big, but some small universities, because of their small size, are able to implement innovations, new ideas, approaches. Kyiv is the first one to think of UKU. These are not typical big universities, but because of their small size, they can move forwards quicker. And the last point, the next issue that the minister addresses is that the higher education cannot be high quality if it is separated from research. The practice of separating research and higher education is the practice which existed in the Soviet Union for many reasons. The system was built like that, but in that system, we got low quality of higher education as a result. The professor who doesn't do research, who doesn't work in the field, from the perspective of a practitioner or researcher, cannot deliver good lectures. It's just impossible.
We tell Tymofiy Mylovanov, this person has a lot of experience of research and lecturing in America, both America and Ukraine. So, Tymofiy, we are ready to listen.
Це людина, яка має дуже великий досвід і досліджень, і викладання не лише в Україні, а й в Україні.
So, Tymofiy, do you read me? While we establish the link with Tymofiy, so Sergey, please say a few words. As a person who knows about the law which was approved 2014, what are the radical changes? Are they radical enough? What must be done better? In terms of radicalism, is it no input? The key problem is a charitable contributions. The government decided to provide everyone with university education. I'm concerned about that. I was asked if I would like to have such a university education, because criterion of comparison of myself, other people with university education does not exist. The percentage of coverage of your youth with university education is very high. But the quality of that education is rather low. Questions from the point of finance. We know that the ministry, through the Ministry of Education, raised more than 6 billion hryvnia to support universities of first to fourth accreditation levels. I would like to ask, is it indeed efficient to use such funds, or whether it was worthwhile to turn to the system where we could have funded the students, the best ones, rather than funding universities, as well as the faculties that nobody knows in the world. This is a true fact. If we ask them, ask our professors, they only refer to domestic sources. I was defending my thesis, and it was just done in the formalistic way. From the perspective of comparability of my contribution to science and the global understanding, it was simply the residual principle of education. I dislike it. I don't tell anyone. I say I have nothing to be proud of. I dislike when we use funds inefficiently. I also dislike when my kid, who is 5, goes to the kindergarten. I know which schools she must join. What can be useful and beneficial for her studies in the university in 10, 15 years? I have a problem because neither happy with school education. I would like something else. I'm not getting it. Maybe it's not a question to the ministry. It's to some about some public changes, new approaches, new projects. However, the laws that were approved, they improve the situation. Overall, the picture is there is education, thank God. With all the Hirsch index, which is the key index to assess success of scientific research, and the success of the particular scientific workers is the level of quotation. As a variant, I asked Yegor to comment. The approach when the state budget and the state order is cancelled, and we allocate 15% of the best students, most successful students who receive scholarships, and they independently choose which university they join. This would optimize public resources and improve competition between universities, because we shall turn from competition of students who choose the students to the competition between universities. Every university will do their best to have the best students. Me, as a student, will see the market situation. I will see who is number one. I will see that Kyiv Mohyla is much better, much more desirable, Kyiv Mohyla Academy, compared to the University of Culture, the singing rector university. That market forms supply and demand. How real it is. This is how it works in Georgia. One of the key problems, key issues in the education is that there is certain template, certain scheme that everyone follows, whether it's necessary or not, whether it's intentional, the students never think, because they immediately want to join the university. Then for those who study on the budget order have no incentives to return anything. In Georgia, there is a system when one receives scholarship, if they want to go to more expensive university, they must do their best, and then they can choose. Recently, the Academy of Leadership was founded, and school graduates 1 year, they separate themselves. Please wait. So for me, I was really shocked. 5 year studies, but actually, it was a new approach which is implemented. It's good that it's there. It's a non-traditional perception. Okay, 5 years I stayed in the university. It was slightly different approach with change of the paradigm. I don't have even words to choose. I don't know what will happen to those kids, but this is very interesting. What you have described is working in Georgia and another the other six countries, so-called the money follows the student model. While you described it, you see that Mohyla Academy is better than Poplavsky University. The main function here and the main responsibility for where the money of the state will be channeled from the state or from taxpayers is up to your choice. It means that we believe that you all have necessary prerequisites to quality choice. You have all the information which is needed to make such a choice, a similarity of going to the store. You look at the goods, you look at the specifications, durability, benefits, and you choose. With such a simplified scheme, it had worked. Can we transfer that model to Ukrainian soil? As editor of transparency rating, I can tell you it's impossible, because the universities are reluctant to participate in that communication between themselves, and they're really slow to demonstrate. They say, what can we get into those educational programs? It's about it's not about some template descriptions taken from the profession classifier, which is kind of long-standing in Ukraine. However, it's about competencies, knowledge, skills obtained during the program. There are graduates who show clearly success of a particular. Everybody knows in the market. It's a second question. Who believes Poplavsky University is high-quality institution in this room? One person. This shows the level of choice. This shows the level of sampling. I have doubts if it is representative sampling of our society. There are indirect studies by democratic initiatives of Karazin University, the focus group, qualitative more than quantitative, about how high is the demand for poor quality education among the Ukrainian public. And you heard me right, demand for poor quality. This is targeted choice of a university program where it's easier to study, where it's possible to give the bribe, where it's possible to avoid the studies and just getting the diploma in the end. Maybe this can be an incentive for reorientation of the system of education, which is motivated by diplomas, by different statistics, about 40% of students are just involved in particular corruption. 30% have faced it directly. 40% review it as normal way for solving problems. And we return to the issue. I describe the problem with choice of a university. It looks that if universities would have informed of themselves, one would know the information. But there is no normal information about the labor market, who earns what. Then it would be possible to say, well, we are ready, let us implement that system. However, the question is, to what extent, even having such information, the person can wait at the age of 16, 17, and to make that choice, which will determine a certain period of the future. I am not saying that education finishes after university. Education also lasts later on. Basically, we are facing a situation when our senior grade students are taken as persons who can independently make such an important choice. For example, in the UK and the States, nobody believes that there is special institute of advisors who study during the senior grades of high school together with parents, with the kid, more or less an adult school person, and they start discussing what it does it mean to study in the university. Maybe some very basic questions, but there is a big difference of studying in school and studying in the university. Why go and joining the universities, and what are the prospects? What are the programs? What you mentioned, the labor market tells us to us, in the UK there is a monthly bulletin which goes into the hands of such advisors and which demonstrate tentative level of earnings of various positions in the labor market in various sectors. Nobody says this information can't be normally processed by people independently. This goes to the advisors who explain with high qualification, explaining what are the numbers, what they can mean to you. And here the question is, which was also touched before that, of funding. What shall we fund? Nowadays, 37% of government funding for education in general is spent for university education, which is not a typical situation even for the neighboring countries or the EU countries, because the prerogative of government financing is preschool and secondary education. They include more, they invest more money to provide for the output after school, not just one variant of going into university. How a school is perceived? It's a kind of jumping board, it's coverage with higher universities, like a jumping board to the university. We don't imagine any other option like going other than going to the university. Therefore, we need to change the system. We have to change the system of motivation and incentives. I will finish up. At least there are two components that are necessary in order to introduce that system that you're talking about, and the second component of choice, making the choice, being skilled to do the choice. It happens when during the senior grades of high school they work with you. It's a profile to already choose some particular direction. Yeah, more conscious choice. Then the risks begin. Discussed in the United States as well as Lithuania. This is another country with such a formula that promotion and advertising wins. Promotion and advertising about what quality education is. The universities start competing with huge promo campaigns, advertising, and this cannot be compared with the quality of education, understanding how to choose a university in such a market of competition and advertising, not quality competition, it's advertising competition, becomes really, really difficult. Because it becomes more and more difficult to understand. Advertising of various washing detergents attacks us from all sides. But a good housewife finds a good product. And competition is always an incentive for development. Most probably, I fully agree that at the age of 15, 16, it's difficult to make choice. And how to develop and where to go. I would like to hear comments, Tymofiy. Yes, I read you. Yes, we do. I will make myself loud. I really like this discussion. It's really interesting. I would like to discuss the outside view, how myself as an economist, as a person living in the States, what I think about education. First, there is clear distribution of higher education and university education, because it principally has different objectives. However, before answering the question, how shall we reform that education, let us think, why do we teach people at all? So we must have answered the questions first. We need to find the best teachers or professors and place them in those places where they can teach. Secondly, we probably must choose the best students who have to study. Because if people go to the college or elsewhere and they dig their nose and drink vodka, why should they go to the college? There is a question, who should study and who should not? Who must teach and who must not? That's the first thing. It's clear that there are best professors and, of course, best students. This discussion which takes place now, how to make it so that professors have academic liberty, the students understand why do they have to study, is based on our willingness to think how the best students meet the best professors. Everybody knows that. This is self-evident. We don't have to respond. There is more specific, more particular question. What is more important, social justice or not? We have the best professors in the country. Maybe there are 10,000 or 1,000. Who should be entitled to study from them? Everybody the smartest or the richest? Today, de facto, a little bit of smart and a little bit of rich do that. However, society must answer this question. If the answer to this question is that they are, we must give every kid the right to study from the best professor, the reform must be done in one way. If answers this question that with the smartest kids must study, and those who are not that smart, they must study in some not so good schools and universities, the reform must be different. If we answer this question that regretfully we have no money to afford ourselves the best teachers, then only the wealthiest must study from best teachers, and the reform must be number three, depending how society will answer this question. This is the way, will determine the way we shall operate. Depending on that, there will be a market approach when we have to privatize and so on and so forth, so that the wealthy people can pay for best universities. Or should we have a socialist approach when you say there is a thing for everyone? Or there must be some hybrid approach when we say the smart people must have the system that professors follow smart people, smart students. It's important to answer the question, who is entitled, who has the right from the public viewpoint for access to the best professors? Unless we clearly answer that question, we shall just make reforms, doing it half-heartedly. No, it's not possible that everyone gets into the best university. It's impossible for everybody to get to Harvard, Kyiv National University, Kyiv Mohyla Academy, the best, other best schools. It's not for everyone. All people cannot get there. We may have to make a choice. We believe in the best schools, who should study? The clever people, wealthy people, or everyone? I would like to hear your opinion. I cannot answer this question. However, it depends on society. I would like to ask a question to other participants of the panel. What do they think about it? Who should be entitled to study in Ukraine? Rich people or clever people or everyone? Starting from Ina, then giving the floor to you to make sure you're not bored. Yegor and Sergei will follow. Good question. Tymofiy asked good questions. The problem is that how the answer is formed by Ukrainian society to this question. There is no obvious answer. What I observe in every discussion about education, that there is a dispute of between two absolutely radical positions. On one hand, we regularly hear the calls, let us make higher education paid for, that everybody must pay for it because it gives advantages for employment, and so on and so forth. And we spend too much money for university education. On the other hand, radical position, populistic, which is about expansion, expanding the access, if state order is reduced, this is a disaster, this is betrayal. Between those two cardinal positions, looking for the medium line is impossible. Because actually, whatever medium line is suggested, both sides of the discussion remain unhappy. What do we have today? What is the societal contract about access to education? Theoretically, we understand that the best people must go for university education. This is done through the opportunity to get supplies in the state order. So-called, if you're not so smart and still you have to study and you also have money, there are places for contract-based education. It's a compromise, a shaking between two radical positions. As a result, we have what? We have a situation that 80% of school graduates get into the university. Not because the government provides too many places. Actually, on state form, there are only 60% of students studying. Just because we don't answer this question that Tymofiy asked, let us clearly define who should get into university education, who should be granted access, and how that objective can be reached. And I believe that here we must understand that we cannot support any cardinal position. Most probably, we should not give an opportunity of just getting into university just because your parents have money to pay for the contract. This is an abnormal situation. As professor in the university, my example is not typical. I teach in the Kyiv Mohyla Academy, which has certain indicators of access to university education. However, there are complaints from other professors that in the universities, just with contract education, the people are coming who should have studied in the vocational schools instead. On the other hand, there is a problem that all of the students, not all of them, 80% of students who study on the state order, they believe that if they are in the state order, they will have to be provided with free of charge education and also guarantee a scholarship. Last year, we started the discussion that scholarship should not be a guaranteed bonus to having university education. I cannot describe you what I have heard from the students' community about the attempts to cancel scholarship. However, scholarship from 12.8 billion, what is spent for university education on the budget, the university education, 5 billion is scholarships. The question is, how do we spend money? Why it is inefficient? 40% is money the government allocates for education for students, not for professors, not for premises, just for maintenance of students. we have to format that understanding. We must say, yes, the best must get into university education. Not those who have money, who indeed can study. The people should study on programs not because they had money, because they know biology and chemistry, and all the others want the same. But of course, this should not turn into populism about guaranteeing other possible bonuses. I would like to hear answers of other participants in this discussion. So, Ilya, you are trying to involve the best people to the online courses, and you are trying to scale and implement this approach to affordable luxury when the best is accessible to everyone. What do you think? What should be the state policy to university education? What should be the motivation? Does it work? No? Not really? Thank you very much indeed. I will quickly start by saying that courses is one of the directions. We work with interactive textbooks, adaptive testology, everything is described on our website nowadays. A lot was heard. I don't even manage to remember. But the main moment is that I believe education in our country is leveled down in terms of value. I absolutely agree that certificate or diploma is ahead of that, and that social perception. How to change it, making it paid for or free of charge, public order, scholarship, all that is not that important, as indeed one has to change the public perceptions in this field. If you ask from a young person of the age 20 to 23, what did you graduate from? It's a surprise. On the other hand, when he says he's about to graduate something, this is no inspiration. I graduate from some place, this causes no inspiration. The problem is that they simply have to do it. This is the same regular routine process as cleaning the teeth for 80% of people, at least for a certain percentage. And that percentage is rather large. The question is, when they say that the government should not give scholarships to the students or free seats or something else, or vice versa, there is another viewpoint that education must or should only be paid for. We forget that those two camps did not appear from nothing. They have appeared for the logical reasons, rather explainable. Why they speak of the paid for and so on? Because this is right. Not everyone should just chase after education just because they want it. To make it paid for, the radical camp quotes example of Kyiv Mohyla Academy, Kyiv National Shevchenko University, and so on and so forth. At least the places when there is some stronghold of education and values of knowledge. Another camp is viewing the quality of knowledge received from a number of other institutions. As they say, well, guys, the government must give scholarships. So you have to pay me to study the university instead of myself paying for that. The social perception must be changed. For that, we need some awareness campaign. We have to work with that. In some place, autonomy for universities is good. For example, I will briefly discuss, very briefly. One and a half seconds. I will be very fast about autonomy. On one hand, I absolutely agree, because I have the case on my department, Shevchenko University Radio Department, when there was a decision from the top that we have to introduce sociology, and instead scientific seminars were canceled. For physicists, one of the most important part of the physicists are scientific seminars, where they must be able to present what their research might discuss, understand how people respond. Instead, it was replaced with sociology. And people were sad because autonomy in decision making is insufficient. On the other hand, there are places, as you were right, some professors are not ready to independently influence those programs, and there must be a certain there is a need for some patronage. Briefly speaking, I can speak longer explaining that with more arguments. However, you know that you must provide access to quality education. For that, you must create quality education. Nowadays, it's not in place. Let's be frank, calling it at least few universities to cover some group of the population with quality education, they are not in place. Therefore, we need, not important whether those are households or state budget, we need a reliable source of financing to cover quality university education. Whom this university is for? Merit-based funding, it must always be in place, whether through institutional funding or private funding, meritocratic. The best people have access to best education. The question is different. For half a minute, can you imagine a high-quality medical doctor who is trained in the Medical University of Ukraine, and the government funds that training is 21,000 hryvnia. 21,000 hryvnia, that's the cost of budgetary plies, budgetary seats, funded by the government. In Ivano-Frankivsk Medical University, the first grade carried three frogs to every class, because university cannot provide the frogs in order to cut them through.
The access to this education will be limited. The number of people who can be covered by this education will be limited, but as a finance per every place at university will increase. A comparison, do you know how much Poplavsky University gets for one place at International Economy School? 48,000. When the medic gets 21,000 hryvnias, and to train an expert in non-core university, it's economics. Economics is not so costly in terms of training as medical school. You need less resources, less technical base. But they spend 48,000 to train one student. We have these imbalances that should be liquidated to create preconditions for quality education. And then we discuss whether we have access or not. Do we need to cover some social scholarships for people based on meritocracy, for those people who don't have money but who deserve that? Thank you, Igor. In the best countries, there are endowment funds. Many best universities in the world are private. In Ukraine, we don't have any success story of successful private university. In Georgia, there is free agricultural university. The universities are private. Their tuition is based on commercial fee. I have been there personally, and there are three opportunities to get the scholarship for the most talented, for those who have innovative developments. There is fund, and there is opportunity to get a loan. It's the alternative to the public expenditures. It's the alternative to looking for efficiencies, which we have to remember of Sergei. I don't see controversy here. Tymofiy mentions an interesting topic. I believe that universities have the best, and everyone has to pay the price. Should be the same for education. The issue is who pays and what is the source of payment. If it's your out-of-pocket money, you have an opportunity to pay. It's one source. Another issue is your municipality can pay you for you. This can be the money from other funds. It can be the state. It doesn't matter. No difference. The cost of one student for university should not be different. It should not be free of charge, because someone has to pay for that. and we're in self-deception when I say it's free of charge. This our taxpayers' money, it's not free. Everyone has to pay, and the universities have to select the best. And competition will resolve this issue of a division between rich and poor and smart, and the number of universities will be reduced. It will be natural selection. Tymofiy, do you want to comment? Can you connect Skype? Yes, I'd like to make a comment. A comment on imbalances, salaries of professors and researchers, teachers, and also price for students. Where I work in the United States, it's standards, and in Europe it's the same. The salary for philosophers, physicists, economists, and financiers, the salaries for professors is different. There is a salary for economics professor, for the well-established professor, it's 100 to 200 US dollars, thousands US dollars per year. For a philosopher, it's going to be $35,000 a year. No one is saying that economists are more important than philosophers. It's a guess, the salary, which is 5 or 6 or 7 times higher. But for the university to compete with high-quality professors of economics and finance, they have to compete with the market, with the Wall Street. This is why they select, they choose, and the salaries are higher. We can fix some salaries, but we have to realize. It may not always work the same with what students pay. Some students pay 2 or 3 times higher than others. Some of them are stupid. They take a lot of courses. This is why they pay more. Some don't have money. They get scholarship. This is clear. But some of them and say, take the same finance or economic or business courses, and professors' salaries are higher, so they have to pay more. When you choose your specialization, you have to realize if you choose different specialty, maybe your costs will be higher twofold. Do you want to do it? We need to realize if we level the salaries, if we level the price of tuition, we'll have some other imbalances, and these imbalances will be, we'll have great people who have no alternatives in the market, and very poor people, very bad people in the applied sciences like engineering or computer science or software development or finances and economists will go to the labor market and make more money there. We'll have some imbalances anyway. We have to choose where these imbalances will be. Either we'll have imbalances that not all salaries will be the same, not all students will pay the same, or we have imbalances that the quality of professors will be different. The imbalances are unavoidable. We need to decide, as the society, as the state, as the market, how to level these imbalances. Thank you. Thank you, Tymofiy. Anyone would like to answer this, Yegor? It was addressed to you. I have to agree the imbalances have to be rational. I have to realize that training a dentist is more expensive than training a cultural studies expert or an economist. You need to have a site and you have to have equipment. It's more expensive to train an engineer. If we build the components of salary in the labor market, we also consider how much it is to train the computer scientists, because they have to take the professors from the market and they will not go for the salary which is below their IT firm salary. I'm not sure we can apply this approach always and everywhere in all specialties, because then we'll lose humanities, for example, social sciences that can just disappear, or there will be just imitation. I suggest to start some other rounds and to tell about fundamental problem of higher education in Ukraine, the lack of trust. We don't have trust to students, do not trust professors do not trust students, professors doesn't trust administration of universities, administration doesn't trust professors, the Minister of Education doesn't trust anyone, and it will never trust anyone, regardless of the personality of the minister or the senior leadership of the ministry. And this trust disappeared because there was the long period of imitation. Everyone was imitating. The professors were told that you have to speak at the conferences and you will be evaluated on that basis. You have to publish in scientific publications, official journals, and they did more of that. They did more publications. They sort of participated in the conference. And the students were told, bring three tools and you'll get your credit test. Or print out what was typed for my monograph. This is what the professor usually asks. And you'll get your test credit. And the financing system is built so that it is not profitable to drop out. Whatever is your level of knowledge, you will just continue through the process of education. You will keep staying there. This is imitation. Everyone understands we're imitating. There is no trust at all. What are the solutions for the problems? We talk about systemic level, about 70% of all solutions for the problems are locally at universities and not at the ministry or at the cabinet of the ministers, not in the parliament. Now, the law has given a lot of opportunities to accept responsibility locally, and many universities start using that. They develop programs of new type. The standards were abolished. There are no new standards. You are free to do what you choose, and they start experimenting actively. People who had ideas, they go to the foreground. If they don't claim for the resource inside university, they can do something, and no one will prevent them from doing that. How do they build their curriculum? They build from the end. They sit down, they discuss among the professors, they discuss with the students, employers, other experts, and they think, what are the competences that are needed for the graduate of the curriculum? What are the problems that will be solved after the student graduates? In mine, in the University of Dnipropetrovsk, there is a program for reclamation of lands after closure of mines or other industrial sites. In Baku, there is the program of computer sciences. Baku is a famous humanities institution and started computer science. In Karazin, they started eco-geochemistry, the program financed by Shell. And there are many examples like that. We do not start with how many positions we need to guarantee for the professors, for our relatives. But we start with the final result, and then we select the resources, the personnel. And this design is called student-oriented, not because the student is creating mess in the program, but the students after graduation should have a good life. I'd like to invite two CU representatives who are not able to attend. It's a typical example of the university, which was established outside the system that develops fantastically, and it impresses with its client-oriented and demand-oriented approach. As they are outside the system on many issues, they have this flexibility and ability to respond quickly to the demand in the society, in the country. As the initiative of alternative approach to education, as you can see, how do you see the future of online education, blended learning formats of education in Ukraine? After that, I would ask the colleagues on the panel to comment. What are the two or three priorities in the context of education reform that should be initiated and adopted as soon as possible? Online education is one of the methods to resolve the issue. For me personally, that someone, the individual, understands the value of knowledge, they get self-education, they get the knowledge as the outcome, as the chance to show people that you got your knowledge, it's good, you can use it. In this context, when we launched our project, we were thinking that if you give high-quality knowledge online, you can prove to people that there is value in that, although it is online. Developing online education, you have to be very careful with that. There are a lot of researches on that. You have to use the basis. You should not just try to have a quick fix, but you need to develop this format with quality. And as United States example demonstrates, it is possible. Also, online education gives opportunity to experiment with great number of people and to put in place these experiments very quickly. We have the platform to, and we can submit some information in text, in infographic or in video, and instantaneously see the feedback of people for these formats. We have the opportunity to do it without papers, to experiment with methods of delivering the materials. It's very important. Also, why online education is positive. It gives the opportunity to create cohesiveness. This is IT cloud technologies. It allows to create cohesiveness among different people from different locations, really good professionals, to create one course, one interactive book. Now, say that online education will revolutionize everything. I don't think so. I think this is just empty discussion. It's just an alternative field for the experiment. It's the chance to look at how programs work, to get real feedback. It's the opportunity to change this and to observe the results. Thank you, Ilya. I'm very happy to hear what Ilya is saying. Very often I hear from people who promote online education. Ilya is the representative of the project, he supports the idea. Often I hear phrases that online education will substitute everything. We'll have no standards universities left, and so on and so forth. Who of you have listened to online courses? It's not representative sampling. Who has graduated the course? Who has listened the course to the end? Less people. The practice shows that online education. I fully agree with what Ilya said. It's the opportunity to try new approaches, to raise qualifications, to get new knowledge. But if you started to be a medical doctor, you cannot listen to a lot of online courses because you need lab, you need to work with materials and so on. And this covers 70% of education. You have to spend time in the lab. The majority of the audience have social humanities education, but who of you wants to have surgery by the doctor who got his education online? Regarding the priority of reform, this is your area of responsibility. Very quickly, please. Regarding the priority, my position is I don't support the position mentioned by colleagues that we should reform the financing system. The money follows students. This is not used anywhere except for Georgia. I don't want to do it. It reorients universities to work on catching students exclusively. It doesn't make them automatically work on the quality of the process. In order to work on the quality of the process, they need to work on buying new labs, enhancing the quality of professors, faculty. It is an integrated problem. Higher education problem is very complicated and comprehensive, and simple solution cannot resolve it. In order to raise the quality of education, we need to think about what people will work in education system, what will be the environment in education. What the ministry did less than 1 year ago, we announced that it's very bureaucratic language, but very quickly, that we will change the requirements to get in the status of associate professor and the professor. According to new requirements to get the status of associate professor or the professor, the teacher has to have international publications, the knowledge of foreign language, which automatically cuts about 90% of Ukrainian professors today to have some international experience, project management experience, and so on. And we were under a lot of pressure in the ministry so that these requirements are not adopted. The environment was not ready. We were told this is impossible. But we are convinced that when we set these requirements, we stimulate the university and the faculty. The most important is to incentivize the faculty. So what should be done as soon as possible to change higher education system? We agree it's not competitive. Can you just give some points? Not competitive. This is what everyone is saying, but still Ukrainian IT experts make a lot of money working for foreign companies, demonstrating that their education is quite competitive. Overall statistic demonstrates, do you know Nobel Prize winners, graduates of Ukrainian universities? In order to get Nobel Prize, it's not enough to be very smart and to have very good education. You need to work in a very expensive lab, you need to have access to the most up-to-date equipment and to a lot of money. Let's be honest about that. So Nobel Prize winners are concentrated in very rich countries, very rich universities, not because they're the smartest, but they have institutional setup for them to make discoveries and to get awards. What we need to work on is we need to have hard discussion on efficient use of funds in education. We should stop being populistic, granting scholarships to everyone. We need to have a rational model of how to finance the education. Does the ministry have its model? On Tuesday, it was presented by the Prime Minister to agree the general vision of how we need to spend money effectively in education. Next is the work with faculty to incentivize them to raise their qualifications through new requirements to international publications, new requirements to research. These are mechanisms which in the long term will bring results. If in 5 years most of Ukrainian faculty will speak English and have international publications, it means you will get better professors. This is what we need to work on. And if we discuss social issues, which the colleagues mentioned, society has to realize that what university gives is not a diploma. You need to go to university to get knowledge. Unfortunately, there is high demand on low-quality education. There is wish to get a diploma, and this has to change. People should reorient and target not only at university, but at other methods of continuing their education. Thank you. Tymofiy, what's your vision of education reform? Thank you. First, what we need to realize is what's the political and economic situation in the future. There is pressure to cut the public expenditures on education. It will increase. It is increased in all countries, Germany, Latin America, United States, and Canada. The level of support from national budget will continue to decline. This is reality. Fortunately or unfortunately, this is what's going on for the last 30 or 40 years in developed countries. Second, the structure of education will change. We need applied specialties, engineering, computer sciences. The impacts of classical education and humanities will fall. Under these conditions, the pressure will be increased to have clear criteria, KPIs. What are the professors, what are the programs, what are the universities to be financed, and what are not to be financed. There will be transition to grant system for financing, performance-based. If we prepare for that and not make one more reform in 5 or 10 years, I would be thinking to privatize the market as much as possible, the market of higher education. And the funds that are saved should be given to secondary education. And in secondary education market, we need to set tough KPIs so that schools are motivated to work well. This KPI should be based on where their students go or general testing. At the same time, the state can continue to support higher education through grants, through students, through projects, through universities. Thank you, Tymofiy. Yegor, your quick comments. We have changes underway. Our society pays more attention to treason rather than to victory. This is why people don't notice that. But we have new programs opening in universities. And the people have all the systemic resources to push it. What will actually happen? And Tymofiy started discussing what we should prepare for. We will have so-called Matthew effect. Robert Merton invented this. Those who have will have more, have notes will have nothing. They will lose everything. Those who are ready for the reform, for the autonomy, for greater responsibility, for some innovations, they will continue to move forward. And Ina said that 10 or 15 universities will have more at the end. And everyone is thinking too much about reducing the number of universities. It will be reduced anyway. The problem is that the society should not call universities what actually are not universities. When I talk about demands, the demand for low-quality education will not disappear. The social opinion will be formed based on the policy of the Ministry of Education. And so this demand should be reduced. We need to have less universities and transparent system and high quality. Sergey. Ina mentions that the ministry develops regulations to teach professors English language. If we call our candidates of sciences to PhDs, they will not become PhDs. What I want to say is the level of our graduates is very low. They are not competitive. Globally, it's our reality. You have to accept it. You don't need to deceive yourselves. You say, we will invent something. Let's adjust the rules. Let's bring different deans. But this is self-deception. Let's think. If we don't have a lot of universities, where will these young people go? They will go to the jobs market, and there are no jobs. Second, they will go to professional education. Why not? Why not dealing with professional education? We transfer it to the local level, and we just forget about this. What's the policy of the ministry on that? Then, we just cannot say that everything is great in the higher education. We need to forget that the ministry should regulate something and adjust something. If we support free market principles, we need to create conditions so that anyone can come and provide this service. And anyone can get this service. We should not deceive ourselves. We should not create an illusion that in 10 years we'll get top best universities. It will not happen because there is no base for that. Maybe it will be Kyiv-Mohyla or some other universities. It's the issue of Kyiv-Mohyla that fights for its right to be here, to be there. It's not the issue of the Minister of Education. Thank you. Thank you, Sergei. Thank you, colleagues. Tymofiy is asking to say that we need to remember that competition, there are competitors in higher education, the Poland and Germany that are our neighbors, and our best students go abroad and don't go back, unfortunately. There are no grounds to believe that these are the best students, especially in case of Poland. And there is no competition for secondary education. I'd like to thank all the panelists for your participation. It's always nice to have several opinions. As Kaha said, he really liked the examples from the medicine. When there is pus in your hand, you should cut it quick for the body to survive. So We need to do it more radically, more quickly, to make some critical and terrifying reforms to help the body to move forward without some limb, but it should be efficient. All the body should not be struck by this disease. The market offers a lot of solutions. I fully agree. We're glad that the ministry team, these are different people than some years ago. These are proactive people. We're always ready to support and generate the content and to help to implement radical reforms useful for Ukraine. Let us thank Ilya, EdEra, Yegor Stadniy, Sovsun, Martin, and Mylovanov. Thank you very much indeed for your participation in the discussion. You can keep your questions, you can ask them individually, and there is an announcement from the organizers. Friends, we have the last coffee break for today. After that, we have a very interesting panel discussion, and I recommend you to stay. We call it changes from the bottom, how to make reform not being in the civil service. It's ironical and logical continuation of today. If you don't choose to stay, I'd like to tell you this. We have a party here at 10 o'clock, only for participants of the conference and speakers. Don't forget your badges, and see you there.